The British animated classic, The Snowman, is based on the book by Raymond Briggs, who set the story around his home in the Sussex Downs.
I remember that winter because it brought the heaviest snow that I had ever seen. Snow had fallen steadily all night long, and in the morning I woke in a room filled with light and silence. The whole world seemed to be held in a dreamlike stillness. It was a magical day, and it was on that day I made the snowman.
Over a 30-year career, Raymond Briggs has sold over 6.5 million books in the UK, making him one of our most popular authors.
I was always reasonably good at art and English. Those were the only things I was quite good at. But then I went to art school. When I applied to go in, had an interview with the principal, and he said, "Why do you want to come here?" And I said, "Well, I want to learn to draw in order to be a cartoonist." And he said, "Good God, boy, is that all you want to do?" And nearly threw me out the room. When I first started illustrating, I found you were given other people's things to do, and some of them were so bad, I thought, my God, I could do better myself, you know. So that's what started me writing.
I think his first picture book was... the one that established him was Father Christmas. And then did this, one of his best and most favourite of books, which is Fungus the Bogeyman. Now, this goes into incredible detail, not just the imagery, but also the words, crafting the words to fit the imagery. It took over 2 years, as I understand it, and one can see why if one looks at the book. So, as light relief, or so he called it, he went from that to this simple, wordless masterpiece, The Snowman, where the wonderful sweep of the illustrations that move, break out from the smaller ones as he builds up the story to suddenly the relief as the snowman and the boy take off and fly, and then we end up with double-page spreads, which just allowed Raymond to express all his emotions through the imagery.
But that's the essence of good illustrating, I think, where the drawer really feels the feeling that the figure in the picture is feeling. You've got to feel what it's like to fly and feel what it's like to slow down as you land. And yet you've got to be outside observing it. Very difficult. I'm thinking of giving it up.
Hang on a second. Norm's come in with a check to sign.
The Snowman's film potential was spotted by John Coates of TVC, the UK's longest established animation studio.
Now, what about lunch?
I got two of my assistant animators, ladies, Jojo Fryer and Hilary Audis, to go and buy a dozen copies of the book, start cutting it up, start putting it under the camera to make a little animatic.
So we went to the pub, as we did in those days, rather a lot, and after about three beers, we had this brilliant brainwave of having them go off on a motorcycle and fall down a badger's hole. And there was going to be a badger's tea party, do you remember?
Or rabbit's tea party.
Or rabbit's tea party. And when we sobered up later on that afternoon, we thought, no way, no. So then we looked to Raymond's other books, and there was Father Christmas, and we thought, well, let's bring in Father Christmas.
I remember John ringing me up and saying, we're thinking of having him visit Father Christmas. And I thought, oh, my God, no. It's awfully corny, I thought. But they did it anyway, and it works very well. It's perfectly good, actually. I was quite wrong about that.
Snowman was one of the first things we did because John Coates was one of the first people to come and see me and tell me he had this going. We were keen on animation. We wanted to do some animation. And John Coates brought this to me, and I thought, it will stick out from among a lot of other things Channel 4 is going to try to do, which will be tougher and more intellectual and more probing and more disturbing. And I just thought this was an utterly delightful project and gave it the nod.
The task of pulling together all the creative ideas of the animators was given to director Diane Jackson, who died aged 51 in 1992.
Diane had worked for us on TV commercials for several years and was a good friend and part of the studio in many ways. And then she took over and storyboarded marvellously well, beautifully drawn storyboard. that was then filmed and became what we call the Bible. And nobody is allowed to alter the Bible except the director and the producer, or with their permission. So we ended up with 26 minutes of still pictures. And then we timed it, which is unusual, but we wanted to do the music to the picture.
This storyboard became the template to which all the animators and the composer worked to create the final film.
It was one of those films where, you know, the tingle factor comes into play. And I remember watching some early line tests that we had with Diane, and we sort of just sort of stopped and looked at each other and said, we've got a classic here. I did the opening to The Snowman, where the little boy wakes up and builds the snowman. And there's a scene in there where he wakes up and he's so excited he has to rush downstairs and he forgets to put his pants on, which is what all the little children always tell me. Why didn't he put his pants on? And the reason is because there wasn't enough time in the scene. You know, I was given this scene and he had to put his clothes on, and all I could do was have enough time to put his trousers on. So that's always caused a lot of puzzlement amongst kids, because it's very important to have your pants on.
Book, the boy and the snowman just get into a car and sit in the car with the garage flashing the lights on and off. And I was a motorcyclist at the time, so we thought it would be very much nicer if the snowman and James got on the back of a motorcycle, because then you're actually in communication with the countryside. You could see what's going on.
There must have been about 8 animators, and they were each given a sequence to do. So Hilary had her motorcycle sequence, and I had the bedroom sequence. And I put extra things in that, for example, when he puts his false teeth in. And I actually got my grandmother to take out her false teeth so I could draw these false teeth. So a lot of these things are very personal to us. As your number plate.
The number plate is mine.
Initials.
On the motorcycle is
59, which was the number of the house I was living in.
James is called James because Jojo at that point was dating a guy called James.
Who's now my husband.
Her husband. And so she just happened to write it on the present, and it sort of stuck.
But in a rush, we make quite a few continuity mistakes, which nobody ever notices unless you point them out. For example, let me think, I think there is a classic example when, after they've been in the boy's bedroom, the snowman and James look out of the window at this motorbike, and on the motorbike is no snow, there's just a green covering. But when they go out, about 5 seconds later, there's about 4 inches of snow on top. Has anybody noticed?
Nope. That's the charm of the snowman, is it's not perfect, and I think that's
what's
charming.
It also has a kind of naivety that I think is probably not fashionable nowadays, which is very sad.
It's the handmade look which we're losing. I think the computer is too perfect.
As you know, most things these days are done digitally in computers with computer painting, but the particular look of the snowman, I still don't think could be done with a computer. It still has to be hand-drawn and hand-crafted.
When the film was first sold to the States, the American broadcaster wanted a new introduction, starring someone famous.
One winter, I made a really big snowman. He got this scarf for me. You see, he was a real snowman.
For the 20th anniversary edition of the film, a new intro is being made featuring an even bigger star, Briggs' very own Father Christmas.
We're doing the introduction in the old traditional way because it has to fit and look part of the whole thing. And it's going to look very nice. It's a much better way of making films anyway.
We have to draw 12 frames for every second of film that's made. And the way you do it is to plan out the scene in broad action first, in rough, doing what we call key drawings, which are the main poses of the scene. Here we have some key frames where he's got his legs in various different positions as he walks across to the chair. And then depending on the speed of the walk, you might, in between these, put a drawing in between each keyframe, which would slow it down a bit and give a certain subtlety to the movement. So you constantly have to think as you're animating of timing. That's really what animation is about, above all else. So when I've finished drawing, it then goes to Jeanette to be painted and coloured.
You slowly build it up, and if you have any nasty little bits that are in the wrong place, you have them. Very technological kebab stick, which will just work as a rubber and take out anything that's in the wrong place. Where his pinny goes down here, all that's got to come out. And the bit on his sleeve is quite nice, to do that little bit of fur there. A frame like this takes about 45 minutes. It starts off about an hour, because there's a lot of them. And then you get the speed up, and so about 45 minutes.
I'm the background artist on this short, and this is quite an unusual technique. It's using pencils, so there's no solid colour, so you're basically just building up layers and layers with pencil, and you get the texture of the paper coming through, which gives it that very snowman feel.
So when the animation has been drawn, it then goes to a cameraman called a rostrum cameraman who shoots it frame by frame. And the background and the cell is put on. Then he places all the drawings on a peg bar so that they're all registered and will line up exactly as we've drawn them. And then he clicks away and we end up with the end result.
Ah, about time for the snowman. Come on, come on, out the way, out the way.
We'd watch it every Christmas without fail. Sort of thing instead of Queen's Speech, watch that. Yeah. Much better.
Yeah, Mum always had it on at Christmas.
It's one of those things you always watch.
Just makes Christmas.
I come from former Yugoslavia, Civil War, 1982, and as first Christmas I saw that film with my three children, and that is now a tradition.
It did take off, and it just goes on and on and on. And children seem to want to watch it over and over and over again. We got lots of marvellous letters.
This is one of my favourite letters connected with a snowman. And it says, to Raymond Briggs, I Ike your Bios. Michelle keeps on saying you're dead. From Dawn. Well, if you're listening, Dawn, I thank you very much for that. It's kept me amused down the years. She's probably aged about 45 now with kids of her own.
The enduring popularity of the snowman has meant that his image is in constant demand to endorse seemingly unrelated products. Last year, over £10 million worth of merchandise was sold in the UK alone. But it's in Japan that there is most demand for snowman products.
Get an awful lot of bathroom products, actually. So there's a loo roll holder, which just holds your spare roll. Oh, I get lots of like, toilet seat covers, stuff like that, really. I mean, the Japanese tend to do... They do tend to want to license very odd things for the snowman because I just think they like the image, and it's not restricted to Christmas memorabilia.
This is another thing from Japan. Japanese chicken nuggets, for some reason, attached to the snowman. I don't know why.
We once got an inquiry for a snowman condom, and it was just basically going to be the snowman-shaped condom, and we sort of thought, can't really approve this, not really a child-friendly sort of thing here, so we couldn't do that one.
The other hugely successful variations on the snowman theme are the theatrical productions, which include a full-length ballet and a musical stage show, both of which have been performed all over the world. and there are plans afoot for the Snowman on Ice. But of course, none of this would have got off the ground without a certain song.
We're walking in the... We're walking through the moonlit sky.
The people far below are sleeping as we fly.
I actually had written this tune way, way back on a beach in Cornwall in about 1970. And it came to me walking along the beach, and I thought it expressed the feeling of innocence.
We hadn't a lot of money to go and record music, and Howard Blake came to visit a friend at the studio.
And John said, well, would you possibly consider? And Howard said, well, he said, yes, it just so happens I think I have something.
And played Walking in the Air, and it was instant magic because it just fitted those pictures so marvellously well.
Wonderful music, Howard's music, and the boy singing. Not Alec Jones, by the way. Everyone thinks it's him, but it isn't.
Alec Jones, just before I hit puberty and his voice broke.
Alec Jones.
Yeah. Yes, Alec Jones. Yes, classic.
Oh, it's that choir boy, wasn't it?
What's his name?
Peter Auty.
Peter Auty, that's right. Bit sad for him, actually, because Alec Jones got all the credit.
I know that everyone does assume that I sang the original version of Walking in the Air on the film, but I didn't.
He's associated with the song, so, and the song's associated with the film, so you put two and two together and you automatically think that Alec Jones did the film.
He didn't have an agent, so we never have this awful thing, but we never remembered to put his name on.
Oh, no! Oh, dear, and he got half a crown for doing it, I expect.
It wasn't annoying at the time, and 20 years gone, it isn't really annoying either, other than... he's probably a lot wealthier than I am.
You know, we're giving Peter Auty a credit now. Oh, good. Reshooting the credits good. For this coming Christmas.
Oh, good, yeah.
As long as it's big and it's got my name in big, bold letters, I'll be happy with that, yeah.
I was chosen to sing Walking in the Air, not for the original cartoon, but for a TV advert.
Imagine a store the size of a sports field, crammed with thousands upon thousands of toys.
At the time they did this advert, which was going out like six times a night on the run-up to Christmas, the single was made and by EMI, and they put it out, and it shot up to the charts.
I think the most frightening occurrence in my career as a boy soprano was when I was asked to go on Top of the Pops, having watched the programme for years and years and years with my friends at school. My biggest worry was, how do you dance to Walking in the Air? I really do remember going into the studio and sort of going to the producer in a very high-pitched sort of Welsh voice, going, how are they going to dance to Walking in the Air? And he said, oh, don't worry, mate, they're going to sway. They're going to sway. And sway they did.
Top of the Pops debut for a 14-year-old Alec Jones, Walking in the Air.
Who looks like you, Mike?
As well as writing the song made famous by Alec Jones, composer Howard Blake scored the music for the entire animation.
Everything that happens in this film is exactly conveyed and given emotion and given shape by the music. You hear them land. Then they walk
back to the house through the snow very silently. This is them shaking hands. Then he turns back and waves, and you hear him run back to the snowman and hug him. And then walk away again. Gets into bed and goes to sleep. And then immediately you go into the morning and you bring back the morning music, which is very jolly, but then you can hear how a minor sixth imposes itself and you realize that he is actually melted. And that is infinitely poignant, merely because it is the minor sixth. That is just a phenomenon, a natural phenomenon of music.
I think the part when the little boy runs out to blazing sunshine and sees a little heap of melted snow is quite a dodgy moment. You hear the odd sob going off.
That is saddest bit, the way we all cry.
It's all a bit tragic. It's all quite sad.
He melts.
Oh. Given that Raymond Briggs was the author, we're lucky it was only that sad.
I didn't think of it at the time, but obviously it's like the death of a person or the death of a friend. And some people have written to me to say, why don't you do Snowman Returns? You know, he didn't really die, and ghastly idea.
I think that children are aware that life contains sadness, that life contains death.
Far From Ending, sadly, ends on an almost mystical note of triumph, that he thinks that the snowman has melted, but in fact, he's got the scarf.
The whole fact that it wasn't a dream, it had actually happened, it's positive, and so you're talking about death. The snowman has died, but he knows that he's had this magical moment with him.
The snowman is his friend, and I think why it touches so many people is the friend melts, and it's something we all experience. We lose somebody we're really very fond of, and he's absolutely heartbroken, but then he has the memory, and the memory is symbolised by the scarf.
Yeah, sad ending. There's no need for it. I thought we could have had a happy ending. I remember crying every Christmas now. There's no need for that. It's meant to be a happy day.
Bright, sunny day the next day. Death. End.